Greetings, I'm Dr. Thema Bryant, the 2023 president of the American Psychological Association, and I am so glad that you are here for our conversation, Mental Health and the Impact on Democracy. Our special guest is Sherrilyn Ifill, civil rights lawyer and scholar, who is the inaugural Vernon E. Jordan Jr. Esquire Endowed Chair in Civil Rights at Howard University. She has had a long-lasting history of working for civil rights and civic engagement, and prior to her current position, she was the 7th president and director of the NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund. The NAACP Legal and Educational Fund has a long history of working for civil rights in our communities. I'm so glad to welcome you here on today.
I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate all of the work that you've done and excited about your return or entrance into the academy.
Yeah.
So working both within the community and also within the academy. So I wanted to start off on a personal note of finding out what were the experiences in your journey that awakened your interest in civil rights and civic engagement?
You know, mostly in my home, we watched a lot of news. My father was kind of a political junkie. And I think I was raised at the time when there was so much that was dynamic happening in this country. You know, particularly being a kid watching the Watergate hearings. And for me, it was Barbara Jordan. It was the first Black woman to be elected to Congress from the South. Barbara Jordan, during those Watergate hearings, her presentation, her power, the power of her voice, the moral integrity, the way she spoke about the Constitution, that seemed like somebody that I wanted to emulate, you know. Yes, there were Black women on television at that time, but mostly it was as entertainers. And she was not that. She was incredibly exacting, and it was so clear she had a moral standard. And to hear her talk about the Constitution and talk about her clear willingness to challenge the President of the United States for having engaged in abuse of power in that room with all of these, you know, white male congressmen who probably did not really want to listen to her, but she had such moral authority in her voice and her presence was so powerful. So that was huge for me. And, you know, watching lots of documentaries about the civil rights movement, I really felt like that was my time and that I had, you know, been born too late, but I should have been part of that. And, you know, so I decided pretty early on that I wanted to be a lawyer and I wanted to do this kind of work. And it was something my father encouraged, you know, very much. So that was kind of my exposure. I feel like I never didn't know or wasn't aware of the issues that affected my community.
Yes. Thank you so much. It's so important for us to see those models and examples of what is possible.
Yes.
And then I know you become that and have become that for so many people coming after you. As I was thinking about the role of psychology as it relates to civic engagement, I know with liberation psychologies or feminist psychologies, there is attention to context, including the political context. But there are some psychologists who are hesitant, who were trained during an era that would say we don't get involved in that realm. And I wonder your thoughts about the importance of mental health professionals being tuned in and civically engaged.
You know, I'm always so conscious of wanting to stay in my lane. So I have no mental health training. You know, this is, I bow before you. You know, I am a civil rights lawyer. But I very much believe that the ecosystem of our democracy is all around us. And it is affecting us and shaping us. And I think that it requires the integration of all of the different pieces of ourselves to navigate ourselves in this space. You know, I'll give you an example. My work as a civil rights lawyer has been, you know, very much focused on police violence against unarmed Black men and women. You know, as a lawyer, as someone who, you know, is going to be on television that night talking about this, some incident that, you know, in which a video has gone viral, as a responsible lawyer, I watch the video. I watch every angle of every video. I watch, videos that you all haven't seen that people have sent in. I've read the police report. I've done all the research because this is such a volatile issue that I have to be accurate. I have to know what I'm talking about. I have to know what I'm advocating for if I am advocating. And to me, that's part of the job, and I do it. But I also have a team of lawyers who are doing it too. And it was very important, particularly around 2015, 2016, to be conscious of the toll it was taking on them. And they made me conscious of it by saying, listen, you know, some of this is too much. You know, there came a point where they said, I'm not watching videos, right? And to me, it's like, we're lawyers, of course we're going to watch, you know. But they were telling me something about what the cost was for them of relentlessly watching this kind of violence and suffering and torture. So I can't pretend that that's irrelevant to my work. I have to be sensitive to that. I have to fold then into our work, you know, what are our mental health days, making sure that we have our employee assistance programs available, creating fun opportunities for us as a staff. The same with COVID, you know, people being isolated and you know, some people living alone. And we suddenly, from one day to the next, in a dynamic workplace where our interactions with each other are so much a part of what we do, you know, that's not happening anymore. And people are cut off and isolated. And, you know, so coming up with Zoom game nights, and like we had to be responsive to the truth and the reality about the fact that our mental health is necessary for what we bring to the table in our work. But it's also true, of course, in our families and in every other aspect of life.
Yes, that's such a great example, because I think about us providing care for lawyers, providing care for journalists. And then, you know, the messaging and visuals are so pervasive that everyone has access to it. And we, this year, the American Psychological Association issued a report on social media and youth. And, you know, there's the positive of you can create community, but there's also the challenge of what you're being exposed to. And so having to be thoughtful about that. So we do have research that shows that some level of civic engagement can have mental health benefits, whether we talk about volunteerism or voting. People can feel a sense of agency, right, that they can make a difference. But yet there are some barriers to that engagement. Specifically, we see around socioeconomic status. We can see around race with voter suppression. And so what are some strategies to address those barriers?
Well, I'll take it back again to, you know, during COVID in 2020. One of the things we immediately started working on was ensuring that there was access to absentee voting. We were, you know, deeply concerned. Obviously, COVID was disproportionately affecting elderly people, people of color, people who were immunocompromised. And so we wanted to make sure people had an opportunity to vote but didn't have to risk their lives to do it. The second thing that was deeply problematic is that most of the people who work as poll workers in our country are the elderly. And this is true in our communities as well. And so we got very, very concerned about whether polling places would even be open. In fact, in the presidential primary in Milwaukee, you know, they normally have 85 polling places open, and there were only five because so many poll workers called in and said, you know, I'm not coming. This was in April. This was the, you know, just as the as COVID was really taking off. And so we ended up partnering with LeBron James, who really stepped up and created an organization called More Than a Vote to encourage young people to become poll workers. And we were successful in recruiting 40,000 people to become poll workers, because we thought this is something young people can do for their seniors. The seniors should stay home. They shouldn't be out. And to get young people into this work of sitting at that desk, you know, being a poll worker, and we're so used to seeing the elderly members of our community do it. So that's like what's like one example of how people can get involved, you know, work being a poll worker and recognizing the ways in which people were vulnerable to COVID during that period. So voting is vitally important. It's important for us to remember that in the midst of this global pandemic in 2020, we had the highest turnout we've ever had in a presidential election. Voters stood online for 9 hours in Fulton County, Georgia, in the presidential primary to vote. The last vote was cast in the Harris County voting center at 1 a.m. That's how much people wanted to participate. There they were with their masks, recognizing the danger, mm-hmm. but needing to engage and to participate. Mm-hmm. So I think voting is a key one. I'm going to say one that I think a lot of people don't want to do and try to get out of, but I want to encourage us to turn that around, and that's jury service. Mm-hmm. It's almost like a running joke that people try to get out of jury service. But you know, the founders of our country almost thought serving on juries was more important than voting, because mm-hmm. you know, obviously the franchise was not even for white men. You know, you had to own property and all this stuff. But jury service was considered vitally important. And so if you have a feeling about what you see in the justice system, whether it's criminal justice, whether it's how you see, you know, matters being handled in civil court, this is your opportunity. And people have an opportunity to have a jury of their peers. But if everybody checks out, then it's very hard for that to happen. And this is your chance to go behind the curtain, to understand how the justice system works, to join with other people that you may have never met before, and to grapple with an issue. And that's part of civic engagement, mm. to grapple with what you've been presented with and to collectively come to a decision one way or another. And so many of us check out of the opportunity to participate in that. And so when you get your notice for jury service, this is part of your obligation as a citizen. Mm. Just as you would vote, then it is your obligation as a citizen to participate in jury service. And I just say one more thing about the voting piece, because when I say voting, I don't mean showing up every 4 years for a presidential election. I mean that there are elections every year. Mm-hmm. And if it's for the Public Service Commission in your state, or the Railroad Commission, or the school board, or the city council, or the sheriff, or whether there are ballot initiatives on the ballot, you know, in a particular year, if there are constitutional amendments, if there are bond issues to authorize money for public swimming pools or the library, all of those things are on the ballot. And when you show up every 4 years, you basically leave all your power on the table, mm-hmm. and you abdicate from the responsibility of engaging around the issues that are most likely to affect you and your family, because it's the local offices that actually affect most of our day-to-day lives. You're not voting for the judges who are going to make those decisions in the criminal justice system. You're not voting for the prosecutor. Mm. You're not voting for the sheriff who manages evictions in the community. You're not voting for the city council and the mayor who make those decisions about how life is going to be lived within your town or community. And I think too many of us don't participate in those elections. Even if we show up, we look at the ballot, and we vote in the high-profile elections, mm-hmm. and then we get to, you know, the railroad commissioner, if you live in Texas, and you're not even sure what they do. But, you know, the railroad commissioner and the public service, they set rates for utilities. And, like, so the research before you ever step into the voting booth, weeks before you are supposed to begin gathering the information, sit with your family, you know, pick a Sunday after your service, after church, or after the soccer game, or whatever, or baseball, whatever you do on Sunday, and you sit down with your materials. There are websites that can help you. Ballotpedia.com, B-A-L-L-O-T-P-E-D-I-A, Ballotpedia.com, mm-hmm. has every race in the country. You put in your zip code, they'll tell you what's on your ballot this year, if anything's on your ballot. They'll tell you what the offices are and who's running. And you can't, there's no excuse for you not to Google and to find out who these people are and what their positions are. Mm. Because this is about your life. It's about your home. It's about your children. It's about your neighbors and your community. And the truth is, most of us abdicate the opportunity to participate in how decisions are made about those things. Mm. So it's not just voting. It's not just jury service. It's also the research that you have to begin to engage in long before you ever approach the ballot box. So November is coming. Right now you should be figuring out, are there any races in my jurisdiction? You should go on ballotpedia.com, and then you should figure out what they are and begin preparing yourself so that you're voting intelligently when you go into the voting booth or fill out your absentee ballot.
Thank you so much for the multiple examples, because I do think people often think one level, mm-hmm. or one layer or one action. But there are so many ways for us to be engaged, mm-hmm. Including running for office.
Yes.
And that piece, yes. is necessary. As soon as you start talking about doing the research, it's like, you know, who's doing this research, or even helping to fill in the information, yes. For people to make informed decisions.
Runforsomething.com. You can, mm-hmm. go on that website. They are training people and helping people figure out how to run for something. There's nothing that stops you from running for school board, you know? Mm-hmm. I think the feeling of disempowerment is not good for our mental health. Yeah. I think when you feel like you have a role to play and that your voice matters, and if you don't want to do any of those things, make sure that you're showing up. Mm-hmm. Decide this year, you know, every quarter I'm going to attend one city council meeting and just sit there and listen.
Yeah.
To what they're talking about and how they're talking and whose voices are heard and whose are not. Mm-hmm. Or decide you're going to go to one school board meeting. Mm-hmm. Or you're going to go to one town hall that your congressman gives. In a year, can you do two or three of those? Can you begin to exercise the muscle of civic engagement? That's what's supposed to happen. You're not supposed to vote and then just walk away mm-hmm. and then talk bad about how the person right. you voted for did. You're supposed to show up mm-hmm. and peek at them in the course of them doing that work. So that they can feel the pressure. So that's the other thing you can do. Maybe mm-hmm. you're saying, jury service, my job is going to give me a hard time. Maybe you're saying, you know, voting, I don't have time to research all these different offices. Mm-hmm. And maybe you work during the day, but you can pick one night to go to a city council hearing. You can pick one night yes. to go to a school board meeting.
Yes.
And just let yourself be seen. Mm-hmm. And think about the message it conveys to your children when they say, where are you going? We're going. Mm-hmm. To the school board meeting. We're going to the city council meeting.
Yes.
We have to begin to exercise those muscles.
Mm-hmm. So that consciousness raising and that sense of empowerment. Mm-hmm. And I wonder about that in terms of trying to offset some people's discouragement, yeah. despair, hopelessness, that it's never going to change or that it doesn't matter or mm-hmm. doesn't make a difference. How do you think about us training our eyes, I would say, to see the progress mm. or to see the benefit?
Yeah, this is a tough one for me because I know that there are many, and every day I hear people say this to me, and people often ask me, you know, how do you feel hopeful? How do you stay optimistic in the work? You know, my life and maybe your life would be mm-hmm. impossible without people who came before us who were living in impossible times, mm-hmm. you know? So, you know, for me to have led the organization that Thurgood Marshall founded in 1940 means that I am constantly pressured by, was constantly pressured by that history. And that's been a part of my life, even now that I no longer lead LDF. These were my heroes when I was a young person. So if you're Thurgood Marshall, if you were Charles Hamilton Houston, the great lawyer and dean at Howard Law School who trained this generation of extraordinary Black lawyers, what would have made you think in 1935, when you were beginning to create the strategy for ending segregation, for doing what they called breaking the back of Jim Crow, mm. what would make you think in 1935 that you could be successful in doing it? What was there in this country, in the conditions of mm. this country, that would make you think that? And I would say there was nothing that would make you think that. You were in the midst of Jim Crow. Mm-hmm. Lynching was, part of American life. Mm-hmm. Thurgood Marshall ended up at Howard Law School because he couldn't go to University of Maryland Law School in Baltimore, mm-hmm. which was, 10 minutes from his house. And so he had to go to Howard Law School. So there was nothing in the environment that would make you think that it would be possible. And yet these people imagined a world that had not yet been created, that they had never seen, mm-hmm. that their parents had never seen, that their parents' parents had never seen. They weren't pointing to some other country and saying, oh, look, we want to be like. They believed those words of the Constitution could be realized, that the word equality in the 14th Amendment could be realized, and they worked for it. And between 1935, when Thurgood Marshall litigated and won his first successful case, which was challenging segregation at the University of Maryland Law School, to 1954 and Brown is less than 20 years. And in 20 years, this entrenched system that controlled every aspect of American life was deemed unconstitutional by the Supreme Court because of the strategy they started mm. in 1935. So the question really for us is, do we have the kind of imagination,
yes.
the kind of spirit, the kind of determination to do what they did? And that's just one example, mm-hmm. but there's a million different ways in which the lives we live today were created by people who dared to believe that things could be different and maybe didn't get to see it. Charles Hamilton Houston died right before Brown. So you may not even get to see it,
right.
but it doesn't mean it's not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're so self-absorbed that you feel like you have to see the change, that's not the way it worked for generations mm-hmm. who came before us. And yet you probably walk into any store that you want to walk into mm-hmm. and you sit anywhere you want to sit on public transportation. Mm-hmm. And if somebody tries to keep you from, you know, voting or doing whatever, you know who to complain to, and mm-hmm. you know that it violates your rights, and you're not afraid to say so. And so I think that it requires from us a bit of humility.
Yes.
And to try to take the long view, which I admit, you know, we're all exhausted. This has been a very difficult last 5 or 6 years. Mm. I choose to try to think about what's positive about it. None of us had ever lived through a global pandemic before.
That's
right. None of us were alive during the 1918 Spanish flu. We had no guidebook. We had no one to tell us how this is how you do it. We had never heard of Zoom or Teams. Mm-hmm. Many of us didn't think we could live with our parents again. Many of us discovered how much we worried about our parents mm-hmm. or our children. And we did it. We lost a lot of people along the way, which worries me deeply.
Yes.
And so I choose to think about what it means, our resilience. One day you'll, 50 years from now, there'll be documentaries about, the great pandemic of 2020. Mm-hmm. And, it will be words on a screen, but people won't know what it felt like and what we did.
Yes.
And we did something pretty powerful and extraordinary. Mm-hmm. And so I choose to acknowledge how heavy it is and how difficult it has been, but to believe in our resilience, and also to believe that we have work to do around rest and grieving. Mm-hmm. And again, I stay in my lane. I don't know how to do it mm-hmm. very well, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And this is where I think mental health professionals come in and therefore are a part of democracy, because we have a country that's lost 1 million people in 3 years. You know, we lost 3,000 people from many different countries on 9/11. And every year we ring the bells, we hear the bagpipes, we think about where we were when it happened. Yeah. We have these heavy feelings of grief. We talked about losing 50,000 Americans in the Vietnam War, and we carried that with a tremendous weight mm-hmm. for quite a long time. But we've lost 1 million people in 3 years, many more, suffering from long COVID and not knowing if they will ever have the life they had before. And, we don't really have an infrastructure that helps us figure out how to grieve. Mm-hmm. How many millions of children are orphans? Where is the infrastructure for that? I can't do it. I'm a civil rights lawyer. Yes. I can't create that infrastructure. But I would love to see mm-hmm. the mental health community see that as part of the contribution they are compelled, that you are compelled to make in a democracy, mm-hmm. is to help us as a country. I worry about a country that cannot grieve collectively.
Yes,
I do think that is part of being a democracy, mm-hmm. because it means you're not hiding the truth. You're not shielding yourselves from the truth. Yeah. And I think these are the bonds that ultimately end up holding us together. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What holds us together is, these moments of collective grief are actually part of the connective tissue.
Yeah.
And yet we're all kind of just doing our own thing, and there's no place, there's no days that we've set aside, where we don't work and we think about this thing. There's no collective set of tools that we've received. And I worry sometimes whether, as I watch the unraveling of many aspects of our democracy, whether we're not just stumbling around in grief.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's so true. We, last month, at the end of last month, the National Grief Awareness Day, and the messaging that we put out through social media, when you heard people's testimonials, mm-hmm. is exactly what you're saying, that so many people have the unhealed grief, and we're kind of given the message to just move forward.
Keep it moving.
Right? Mm-hmm. And that we're going to be strong, we're going to be resilient, but not leaning into our humanity mm-hmm. and to have permission mm-hmm. for that. So in the wheel that we created, the first part of the wheel is just permission to feel your feelings, right? As opposed to like, I'm fine. How are you? I'm fine, right? Or in that faith-based space, I'm blessed.
Blessed.
Right? So we know the script, but like people are crumbling. And across the age range,
no question.
Children, you know, you brought up those who have lost their parents, children all the way to elders. So the feeling our feelings is important. And then like real relationship support so that we don't have to remain on a surface or superficial level. Mm-hmm. We don't do public relations. Mm-hmm. And then being able to access mental health support, quality and culturally informed mental health support, because the way that we grieve is connected to
That's
our
right.
faith and our culture.
That's right.
And then even thinking about how do we honor the people that we lost?
Yeah.
You know, honor their legacy, honor what they taught us. And when you were talking about how some of the, one, us needing that radical imagination, which I think is so important, and then saying that it may, we're not going to get it all in our lifetime. Mm-hmm. And we've been highlighting this year indigenous psychologies and one of the kind of lessons from that is always looking seven generations. Mm. And so seven generations back, seven generations forward. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, can fuel the hope of, like, what am I doing? Is I have my eyes on like the unseen, right? What we haven't seen, but moving in that direction.
And believing, believing that what you do shifts the atmosphere in some, you know, powerful and important ways. And I would add something that I feel like we've learned from young people who really, certainly in my work, have introduced the idea of self-care. That was not something I ever learned anything about, you know, and am bad at it.
Yeah, we'll just say keep going. Pushing.
Right. The need to rest, that it's good to rest, that it's good to enjoy yourself, you know, and to be able to check out. And, you know, I love going on hikes and, you know, it, the Japanese phrase is to have a forest bath, you know, having a forest bath, you know, and just finding those things. And I really credit particularly young activists for being insistent about self-care and about the need to create space for us to take care of ourselves. I feel like that's something that came to us over the last 5 or 6 years, which is a really good thing. It has changed the American workplace.
Yeah.
You know, people talk about quiet quitting. No, people have decided that they're not going to allow themselves to be exploited and used in ways that are harmful to them. And I think it's very exciting. We're on the cusp of something. So even that, even people's sense of like being overwhelmed and not wanting it, like that is a contribution to something that is shifted. You know, we didn't always have the 40-hour work week, you know, or weekends, right?
Yes.
Something happened and a movement happened to shift that. Mm-hmm. And now we see other movements happening. We're seeing people striking and demanding better conditions and better pay. And so I think we're in the midst of something and that should give people hope that, you know, that's what time will do and experiences will do. It allows us to bring to the table those things that the current generation needs. Mm-hmm. And when we lean into that, we make change.
Yes. And I'm so glad you named young people and activism. We've done some research about both the mental health costs of activism, but also how to make it sustainable, right? Which is the self-care and community care, because that's the only way you can keep going when people say, you know, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you do a marathon? It's like you have to nourish ourselves, right? And give ourselves permission when they say rest, but don't quit.
Yes.
And we can rest.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I always, you know, I liken it to battle, you know, or being at sea. You know, you get shore leave or you come away from the front, you know, you get a pass, you know, and then others go to the front and you're in the back. And, you know, so I always think of it as a relay race because I feel like you're passing and passing and passing and passing. You're not running the whole race.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do think and I'm preaching to the choir right now because you're preaching to myself because I'm bad at this. In terms of just knowing when to ease the throttle, you know, because everything feels very urgent. And it is. But what is also urgent are the needs of your body and the needs of your mind and the needs of your spirit and the needs of your family and to be a good friend and you know, and you feel it when you have checked out of that in the service of the work.
Yes. One of the things I love when you talk about like us not knowing how to do it and not having often seen models for how to do it, and especially if you're a part of a marginalized group, feeling the urgency, or even those who are allies who feel the urgency. At first, I used to think, well, people don't know what to do, but then I realized people could like name 10 things you should do, and then you know the thought was it was time management, but you know. We figure out time for the things that are the priorities.
Yes, yes.
And so, you know, I really came to this piece, I think for me, was around worthiness, that we believe other people are deserving of the good things, right? It's like they need it or somebody helped them, but like, can I like lean into my own worthiness?
Come on, bring this session. Right. I need this session. Let me lean in. Let me lean in.
So, like, I'm worthy to go lay down. Yeah. Like, I'm worthy to say, no, get somebody else to do
it,
right?
Yes, yes. And that, you know, that thing of being able to say no, not to say no for no sake, but to say no in the way you're describing.
Yes. Because I have to say no to some things and say yes to myself, including yes to my health, to my mental health, to my peace. And that's one of the things I like about in decolonial or liberation psychology, we say, we don't just need coping strategies, we need resistance strategies. Mm. And usually when people hear resistance strategies, they think about the activism, right? But when we say rest is an act of resistance, so Trisha Hersey has a book,
right? Yes,
oh my
gosh, she's amazing,
incredible?
The nap ministry, yes.
And to say, like, joy is an act of resistance, because before when you were describing, like, these long voting lines, I remember this video that was going around social media, I believe it was in Philadelphia. These folks have been in line all day, and they were doing the electric slide.
Yes.
So it's like, how do I
find joy in it?
Yes.
I think about some of those nights that we were on Versus watching these music, right?
Yeah.
During COVID. Like, those are some of my fondest memories where we were kind of somehow all talking to each other, and sharing the culture. And it can be incredibly beautiful. And it is hard to begin to fold that into like your regular practice and how, you know, my therapist says protect your yes, you know, which is not like something that I feel like could do, you know. In fact, I felt like the yes is an obligation, like that it goes with this work. So putting yourself inside just inside the ecosystem, like you're not like acting on something that you're outside of, you're in it.
You're in it, and right? We're being affected by it.
Yeah, and you have to figure out how to care for yourself and believe yourself worthy in that. So that's a process. You know, I'm in process, but I encourage people to do it earlier than me. I'm an old lady, and but it's important. It's really important.
Yeah, and it is also for me realizing I'm not the only one who can do it, right? Because I think sometimes we say,
We
feel like if I say no, it's going to be a disaster. If I say no, it's going to fall apart.
Well, I think about a lot, like the narcissism that's involved in saying yes all the time.
Right. Me and me alone.
Because what's great is when you say no to something and like with a quickness, they get somebody else who's fantastic.
Exactly.
And you're like, hey, wait a minute, you know? So it's good for you.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
And even my, I mean, the thing I'm in some ways proudest of is deciding to step down from leading LDF. I mean, here is an organization that I love, that I feel like I was made to do that job. And I was, you know. Doesn't mean forever though, you know. And to be able to say after nearly a decade, you know what? Not only can you step away, but you have so wisely prepared your deputy that you know exactly who should step into this and she will be amazing. And we were very intentional about that. You know, and even as we were leaving, we were very intentional. We had we agreed we want this to be beautiful. Like, so we created it as its own thing. It's like in some ways with all of the cases and the lawsuits and the policy wins and the I'm almost proudest of that, that we transitioned leadership in a great and powerful and important Black institution.
Yeah.
Yeah. Woman to woman.
Yes.
Which was also very important. We showed it could be done.
Yeah.
And that it could be done with excellence, that it could be something that felt spiritually, I think people could feel that we loved each other, that we were really into this thing, and with the confidence that the organization was in good hands. That was the biggest, the hardest thing I ever did, because I love that organization so much and because I knew I was good at it and could do it a little bit longer.
Yeah.
But to say, just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Right.
And why don't you leave before you have no juice? Mm-hmm. And why don't you leave at the time that your deputy can really be ascendant? You know, like even looking out for somebody else's pathway. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, that was really a huge milestone in my life, just for how I engage with the work.
Yeah.
The ability to step away. And I felt that it was powerful and important to model that, especially for other Black leaders, because we often feel like we can't step away.
Right.
And I think it weakens organizations, to be honest, when we stay too long.
Too long.
You know, every organization is not, you know, a Baptist church that you know, it's 30
forever.
Years and you stay forever. Like, it's not, that's not it. So this to me was like, and it took a lot to be able to do it, but I feel on the other side of it, like it was one of the most important things I did.
Oh, it is. It is. Mm-hmm. Because that succession planning and that mentorship.
Yes.
It is an act of care, right? For ourselves, for the other person, for the organization.
For the institution.
Right? As opposed to thinking to be the martyr, I must continue to carry it all. And that's a setup for disaster.
I think so. You can stay at the game too long, and you know, and I was fearful. I'm a you know, workaholic, honestly. And I was like, what I mean, what am I gonna do, you know, if I don't have? And then it was just like, just, you gotta just trust, you know. For me and my faith, it was like, trust that, you know, God has something for you. You know that.
Yes.
And that this is a pathway, you know. You can keep doing the work, but you don't have to keep doing it in the same way. There's so many angles to come at, you know, the work of justice or the whatever is your work. You don't always have to do it in that frontal way. And so I felt confident about that, and I got excited about the idea of doing it in other ways. But it was really important to me, and I truly believe that that is a part of leadership.
Yes.
A part of leadership is thinking about when you're going to step away, planning for it, developing a leader, and coming to stepping away with peace, you know, not only for you, but for your staff.
Right. Right. Because then they can feel
that we're
all prepared.
Yes, we're all part of this thing. Yes.
Yes. So I wonder, many times our focus is on the barriers, the issues, the challenges. Mm-hmm. But since you raised this issue of imagination, you know, what does justice look like? What does a liberated society look like? You know, what are we hoping that we're moving toward or trying to create?
I hope that we're creating a country in which the core, in which we are centered around the core values of equality and justice and dignity for every person. It's not just enough to be equal before the law. It's not just enough to experience justice. Opportunity is also a huge part of it. People need to feel that they can strive. You know, I hope that we're moving to a place where there is a floor, where everyone has basic subsistence in terms of being able to eat, being able to have a place to live that is clean and safe. But I also think that it is important that we regard dignity as a central part of the democracy we want. And I don't think I'm just making that up. You know, we're the only, you know, country whose foundational documents talk about happiness, you know, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So it's not, I didn't just pull it out of thin air. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equals in the Declaration of Independence. I didn't make that up. And, you know, if we think about so many of our laws and our rights are centered around the idea of dignity, the dignity of your home, that you know, officials can't just enter your home without a warrant, mm-hmm. right, and search your home, that officials can't tell you what religion you have to mm-hmm. to observe, right? These are all things that go to human dignity.
Yeah.
And so I think we need to spend more time talking about that as we mm-hmm. engage in contentious issues around, you know, whose love we will recognize, mm-hmm. around the physical integrity of women, of members of the trans community, of LGBTQ people, to talk about it within the context of thinking about dignity. Mm. How do we allow people to live with dignity? Everyone who has to be in front of their children, there's a wonderful part of Martin Luther King's letter from a Birmingham jail where he talks about, you know, his kids wanting to go to some amusement park, mm-hmm. and, you know, how often he made excuses about why they couldn't go, and then he had to explain, they don't let us go.
Yeah.
Right? And how that made him feel as a man and as a father.
Mm-hmm.
So we could talk about that from, you know, the legal perspective, but we also can talk about that from the dignity perspective and what it means to create a world and to create and to be fighting for a country in which parents can have dignity in front of their children. Mm. Being able to feed your children is a dignity issue, not just a matter of economics. Mm-hmm. You know, having a job to go to every day is a matter of dignity, and being able to tell your children with a sense of honesty that there's a life for them, you know, that will be a good life.
Yeah.
That's the world that I'm fighting for.
Yes. I love that. And it, you know, echoes for me, some will call it positive psychology or community psychology, that we want more than, we would call it symptom cessation, like reducing distress.
Yes.
But for like, what does flourishing look like?
Yes.
What does thriving look like? And so naming both of those, the happiness and the dignity at the core.
Mm-hmm.
And no one would debate that that's a part of our role, right? As psychologists,
that's right.
Whether in applied or research or teaching or practice, to be intentional.
Mm-hmm.
So for the final question, I want to ask about your evolution, because with all of the success, you mentioned having been open to therapy, and then I also know that your daughter is entering the field.
Yes, yes.
And so for someone who didn't maybe grow up seeing a lot of models of self-care, what opened you up to psychology?
My sister, I have a sister who's a year older than I am, who is like my best friend, and she's a doctor, she's a psychiatrist. You know, so just my respect for her and what she's able to do and the weight of what she does, which is incredibly heavy, and her excellence, you know, obviously made it very clear to me how important this is, but it didn't bring me into it, you know. I think, you know, I'm so proud of my daughter. You know, people ask me all the time, are your kids, you know, lawyers? And none of them are lawyers, you know. I'm just very proud of her for you know, for what she's done already in the field and how many young people she helps and has helped, you know, in her work. And it seems so extraordinary to me that she can be so helpful to me. Like I feel like I learn from her all the time, you know. And I just think at the end of the day, you're going to run up on it, or it's going to run up on you.
You know? Yes.
You know, sometimes it's through grief. I lost several siblings over the course of a decade. I lost my cousin Gwen. Like, and I was working at breakneck speed. Like, so lots of unprocessed grief, and like it's going to happen. You know, and so I think it really is part of recognizing the whole of yourself. You know, it's like people who never worked out and said, "Well, why did you start working out?" Well, you know, because your body is also part of this equation. And how are you engaging with your body, you know? So I think feeling like you have permission to be a whole person and to attend to all of the parts of you. And so I think many of us, you know, I worked out from the time I was young. You know, I grew up in the church, so you're attending to your spirit, right? You know, I loved school and workaholic. You attend to all those things. And somehow kind of the mental health things are supposed to just kind of come along with the program. And I love that people are much more intentional about it now. And I would encourage people to do so. There's certainly no shame in the game. But in the same way you would think you had to get in your 10,000 steps, what's the equivalent of your psychological 10,000 steps? What's your ritual? What are the things that you do to help your mental health? And again, as I said, I'm on the outside of this, just learning and trying to do these things myself.
Yes.
So it's never too late, but they're just such tremendous benefits to it, to knowing yourself. I think we all want to know ourselves.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
And be known.
Mm-hmm. Both. So true. Well, this has been such a delightful conversation, and you have given us a lot, not only to chew on, but to do. And so for those who are watching, I really hope that you will engage in our advocacy, voting. We sit not only on the federal level, on the local level, serving jury duty, not just looking to get
That's
out
right.
of it. And then our acts of resistance, including our rest and our self-care, and holding on to the dignity of ourselves and those we serve. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.